Good morning and welcome. Thank you for joining us at this session, Art Workers Are Essential, the Creative Workforce Movement. Californians for the Arts has arranged for all meetings today to offer captioning. If you would like to turn this feature off, the bottom right-hand side of your Zoom screen provides you that option. Today's programs will be recorded for future viewing and availability. I want to direct everyone to the chat box located at the bottom of your Zoom screen. During this webinar, this will be the best way to communicate with your fellow participants as well as the panelists. Please go ahead and test it out by introducing yourself and sharing how you are affiliated with the arts community and where you are located. Just like in personal meetings, Californians for the Arts expects that all attendees represent themselves and treat panelists and attendees alike with mutual respect. As you review the slides on the screen, understand that Californians for the Arts recognizes that radical change is required to address centuries of racial, economic, social, and cultural injustice in our state and in our country. As the only comprehensive multidisciplinary organization focused on advancing and building public awareness of the value and impact of the arts, focused culture and creativity in California, we acknowledge the necessity of conducting ourselves with attention to these histories and their ongoing impacts. Please be respectful and thoughtful today. During the program today, the chat box will remain open during the entire session. As a reminder today, the remaining program for the rest of the afternoon remains open for registration. If your schedule has availability, we encourage you to join us by registering at californiansforthearts.org. Now that the housekeeping is taken care of, I want to introduce our moderator, Gustavo Herrera, the Executive Director of Arts LA. Gustavo, thank you for being here and leading this session.
Thank you so much, Tara. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome. Welcome to our afternoon panel. Welcome to the annual Californian for the Arts convening. Just a huge, huge shout out, I think, to the Californian for the Arts team. I know that this has been a tremendous, tremendous lift and endeavor to bring us all together as a community of folks who care deeply about the arts. And so just a giant shout out to the California for the Arts team and also everybody who's been involved and all of you, I think, for showing up and being a part of this. So welcome to our afternoon panel. This panel is called Arts Workers Are Essential. And this is a panel on the creative workforce movement. My name again is Gustavo Herrera, and I'm the Executive Director of Arts for LA. I'm also a proud board member of Californians for the Arts, and I'm so, so excited to be your host, to be your moderator or conversation moderator today. So we want to kick off today's panel with a performance. There is no better way, as you all know, to feed our souls, to connect us as a room of arts advocates than the arts. So at this point, it's my honor really to introduce a Bay Area native, Antoine Hunter, also known as Purple Fire Crow. Purple Fire Crow is an award-winning, internationally known African-American, indigenous, deaf, disabled choreographer, dancer, actor, instructor, speaker, producer, and deaf advocate. Antoine, AKA Purple Fire Crow, creates opportunities for disabled, deaf, and hearing artists and produces deaf-friendly events. And he also founded the Urban Jazz Dance Company and Bay Area International Dance Festival. With that, I'll let us cue up the performance and enjoy, everybody.
No. You never saw the tournament? And at that time, no.
But you know who did it?
Yeah.
Were they caught?
No, I don't know. Court police. Just, you know, when I came.
Amazing. Let's put our virtual hands together for Purple Fire Crow. Absolutely love that name too. What an amazing, amazing, powerful performance. So let's at this point move to our panel discussion. I gotta be honest here, I am so, so excited to introduce you to our panelists that are upcoming. I think this is a real, real amazing opportunity from us to just learn from national thought leaders and folks who are really doing the work in the workforce movement space. And so with that, Tara, if you can help me here, I am going to read a little bit about Deborah. And if you can bring up Deborah as I read about her. Deborah Cullinan, CEO of Yerba Buena Center for the Arts. Deborah is a nationally recognized thought leader in the arts. And prior to Yerba Buena, Deborah was the executive director of San Francisco's Intersection for the Arts. She is the founder of Culture Banks, and she serves on several boards. She serves on several boards. She also currently is on Governor Gavin Newsom's Jobs and Business Recovery Task Force. If you all have been watching Deborah, like I have, she has been an incredible, incredible leader. I think she has a long history of leadership, but certainly since the pandemic hit, there is such exciting stuff coming out of Yerba Buena and the Bay Area. And it's just such an honor, Deborah, to have you join us. Next, I am going to introduce a good friend, Vantan Quinlevan, who is CEO of Futuro Health. Van is a nationally recognized thought leader in workforce development. Prior to Futuro Health, Vaughn served as the Executive Vice Chancellor of Workforce and Digital Features for the California Community College Chancellor's Office. Her career spans the public, private, and nonprofit sector. Vaughn serves on the boards of the National Skills Coalition, the Western Governors University, and California Forward. And our third panelist is the amazing Brooke Ishibashi, who is an actor, singer, and founder of Be an Arts Hero. Brooke is a fourth generation Japanese American who I love this, she hails from a showbiz family. She is passionate about exploring anti-racism, social justice, and transgenerational trauma. Brooke is a co-founder of the powerful Be an Arts Worker movement. She is also a member of Fair Wage on Stage. She is a national counselor for Actors Equity Association and a black belt in Taekwondo. So let's bring, well, I think all of us are already up on stage here. And this is an incredible, incredible panel with a wealth of knowledge and a ton of experience to bring to this conversation on the creative workforce movement. So I wanna first welcome our panelists. Thank you all so much for joining us for this conversation. So I'll start with our first question, which for us in the arts community, the arts are really a field of storytellers. And so I know I just shared all of your amazing bullets and, you know, everything that you've accomplished professionally, and it's a whole lot, but I'd like to start with your personal story. Can you tell us, and maybe let's start with Deborah. Can you tell us your story, Deborah, your journey, and what led you to where you are today?
Sure, I'd be very glad to, and I'm very glad to be here. I'm coming from San Francisco, the land of the Ohlone Ramaytush people, and I'm very glad to be here for this conversation. My story, you know, I think that my story and my journey, particularly my work journey and my passion journey, is very rooted in growing up with my mother, who was an immigrant who came here to this country on her own when she was just shy of 17 years old. And she was born and raised in Scotland and was coming here to try to make a better life for herself, her mother, and her twin sisters. And my mom approached everything with creativity, with poetry, with music. And so that was very deep in me from when I was young. But combined with that is my commitment to social justice. And I would really define myself as an activist more than anything else. And I feel very strongly that we cannot solve the problems that we face in society if we don't start with imagination. And that it's going to be creativity, imagination, big thinking, wild ideas that will get us from here to where we need to be. And so I'm just very driven by trying to help people understand that artists and the arts are essential.
100%.
Thank you.
Thank you, Deborah. Thank you for sharing your story, for sharing sharing your mom's experience coming here as an immigrant into this country. That very much resonates with me. And so thank you for sharing. Vaughn, would love to turn it to you.
Well, Gustavo, thank you for your continuing leadership in the public policy arena. It's real pleasure to be here today. You may not know this about me, but I actually grew up with 12 years of training as a classical pianist. And the reason behind that is actually my father. So my father was an orphan and he loved music, and he would tell us stories how he would look at night. You know, he could hear in the building next door someone playing the piano, and he always wanted to have that opportunity for himself. And so in the moments when I didn't want to practice, I would recount his story and how much he wanted to learn the piano. I also share, you know, like Deborah and many others, it's the story of a first generation immigrant. And so, you know, our family was a part of the Vietnam War, and in 1975, we escaped here as refugees. Interestingly enough, you know, my father was a neurosurgeon and my mother was a teacher, which is a very venerable profession in Vietnam. You know, both of them were, you know, high in their career. And then coming here to the United States, they had to start over from scratch. So, you know, we're products of food stamps and lunch tokens and all the community social services. And what is striking to me was that my parents were never bitter about that transition. And instead, they were always very grateful grateful for the opportunity to restart and build a better life. And they imparted those, in addition to piano, the love of piano, they also imparted this concept of opportunity. And I feel like the work that I continue to do, whether with the California community colleges in the private sector or now with Futuro Health, it's all about paying forward opportunity to others, because I feel so grateful for that opportunity myself.
Absolutely. And I know you've been a tireless advocate, Vaughn, for creating opportunity for future generations, and always keeping in sight that there are a lot of folks who don't have equitable access to those opportunities. And so it's so great to have you here, Vaughn. Now that I know that you have a history of playing piano, you are not leaving the arts advocacy world now here, because you have a personal story and connection to the arts also. And I think at this point, I'd love to turn it over to Brooke and would love to learn a little bit more about you also, Brooke.
Yeah, of course. And also thank you for having all of us here. I'm so excited to be here. You know, I come from a lineage of artists. My entire immediate family were all musician, entertainer, actor, performer, producer types. And going back to my parents' generation, so my grandparents were all, I'm Japanese American, I'm fourth generation Japanese American. And my grandparents and all of their friends and family members were all put into prison camps during World War II. And so I think there's in my bloodline, I think I've always understood that trauma, and I've always had a burning desire for social justice. It runs through my veins. And so my grandmother, who's 95 and in incredible health, she just got her second dose, she's doing great. Her name's Mary Kagayama Nomura, and she was known as the Songbird of Manzanar. Manzanar was the camp in which she was imprisoned, and she was the camp entertainment. So even in those, you know, awful times, they were afforded some amount of entertainment, and it was my grandmother. And so there's always been a history of music and entertainment in my family. But even from a very young age, I think I was 5 or 6 years old, and my mother asked me what I wanted to be when I grew up. And I said, I want to be a tap dancing doctor, because I want to help people, but I want to entertain them too. And so I think from a very young age, I understood that there was an intersection between arts and service. And so as I went to New York City, did theater all over New York while I was growing up, out of college, I hungered for that. So I found the Fair Wage on Stage group. I became a national counselor with my union for stage managers and actors. And then I co-founded Be an Arts Hero out of this pandemic, because knowing the life of a struggling arts worker, coming from a family of struggling arts workers, I understood what it meant to feel as though we had to save ourselves. And so Be an Arts Hero was really founded out of a desperate need through this pandemic, because we realized that there needed to be real systemic change, but also that, you know, power's in the people. We needed to make our voices known to our lawmakers. So I'm really a new kid on the scene. I wasn't trained in this, you know, and I didn't envision that my 2020 and 2021 would be spent doing arts advocacy. I thought I'd be working on a TV show or working on a contract in New York City. So I found myself here kind of by happenstance. I'm very happy to be here. But it was a bit of a winding road to get here that was a little surprising.
And, you know, Brooke, we are so happy that you're here with us. There's no better place to have a tap dancing doctor in our presence than here, because we have Vaughn representing an incredibly powerful movement for health workers and all of us who are of course fighting for arts workers. So it's that perfect blend. Amazing. Thank you for sharing your stories with us. I think the reason that I really asked for you all to share your personal stories with us is because, as advocates, so much of our personal story comes into the type of advocacy that we do. There's so much crossover in the work. And so really appreciate you sharing that with our audience today. I want to turn the conversation at this point to the topic at hand, this conversation is really intended to be a discussion around a creative workforce movement. I want to share a couple of data points. So and I'm going to focus here on the state of California. California's creative economy is the largest in the world. It represents about $230 billion. COVID has brought much of that economy to a standstill. And I'll share with you, Americans for the Arts, which is our national arts advocacy organization, or one of our national arts advocacy organizations, reports that 96% of creative workers lost revenue or employment because of the pandemic. This is a national number. In California, There are approximately 764,000 creative workers in the state of California. Over 450,000 creative workers are unemployed due to the COVID-19 pandemic. And this is, you know, to put the creative workforce in the broader perspective, the creative workforce represents about 8% of California's entire workforce. And so we strongly believe that California's economic and civic recovery will depend on returning as many people in the creative economy as rapidly as possible, getting folks back to work. But before we dive into the first question, you know, I share all those numbers about the job loss and it's been devastating to the community. But I just want to make a point that the devastation hasn't been equally felt. And when we look at the numbers and we really drill deep into the numbers, we know that BIPOC artists, BIPOC-led organizations have had all sorts of additional challenges above and beyond what the normal data indicates. And so if y'all were a part of the conversation that was the opening session this morning, I think it was Nina with Americans for the Arts who shared that for every data point on loss that is experienced in the field at about 10%, and that's how the BIPOC community has experienced the challenges. And so I think at this point, I'd like to start with, I guess my first question here for the panel, which is crises can exacerbate inequities. Structural inequities exist in arts and culture. They exist in our healthcare systems. They exist in our workforce pipelines. What can we in this moment as advocates do to ensure that we do not let the foundational equities that have existed in the arts and culture field worsen as a result of the public health, the economic, and the racial justice crises? And I'll let whomever wants to jump in here, jump in, please.
I'll jump right in because I have so many feelings about this, Gustavo, as you know. I think for me, my gut reaction is to say we can do so much. I don't think we're doing enough. I think it has to do with leveling a playing field. But in order to do that, we have to do a hyper-correction of sorts. You know, it's the idea that if it looks as though it's 50-50, you know, that still is not even. If it's 50%, you know, if we're looking at sharing a pie and 50% of the people who get the pie, you know, that's perhaps all white identifying people. And then the other 50% of the pie is shared by everybody else that isn't actually truly equitable, right? And so in order to level the playing field, we have to hypercorrect, we have to disproportionately invest in the most marginalized and oppressed and disadvantaged communities in order for it to actually start to level out. So we need to put a disproportionate level of engagement, education, and efforts, awareness in that direction. So what I'm learning, you know, as sort of a newcomer on the scene is that it's about who's invited into the room and who has a seat at the table and how many seats we have at the table. You know, our partners at Americans for the Arts are so amazing, and they do regular think tanks, and they brought us into the room. And we hadn't proven ourselves at that point, but they brought us into the room because they valued voices of new grassroots organizations who were boots on the ground. And so we in turn brought our friends and our colleagues into the room for those think tanks. So just by them setting off this chain reaction, it created a domino effect of dozens of new faces in this room where the decisions were being made, where real impactful conversations were being had. So I think for me, it's a bit of a multifaceted answer, Gustavo, but I think when I ask myself, what can we do? You know, we need to double, triple, quadruple up our efforts in educating and organizing and mobilizing folks. because it's first, we need to know that there's a problem. We need to understand what the problem is. So that's the education portion of it. And then I think it's a large part of the work has to do with literally bringing people into the rooms where their voices need to be heard, where their voices are being erased or not acknowledged.
I hear you. So what I'm hearing you say is to address some of the inequities that existed prior, to have really targeted efforts to those communities, being very cognizant of who gets brought into the room, as that's important, and more of a focus on the organizing of our communities as the other. Absolutely. Yeah. Please, whoever else would like to step in or jump in.
I'm happy to jump in. I mean, I think in the context of the topic for today, the creative workforce movement and all of the good work that is being done to really help us all understand the essential role that artists play. For me, I think there's a couple of different things that come to mind. And I actually think, you know, to Brooke's point, there's a million things that we could and should be doing. But one thing I feel is very important is that we never start from here. We start from where we have been and what we've done wrong. And we take into account mistakes that we've made and steps that we've taken to build just systemic and structural inequity and racism. And it feels like we just aren't very good at contending with our history and what's led us here. So that's a first piece of it. It's like, first we have to do that, and then we have to do what we can to repair and to, as you said, Brooke, to level set or do more than that in order to build the future that we all want to have. And I think, you know, with Governor Newsom's task force, one of the things that I think helped, at least helped, was that the task force itself adopted equity principles, and that every move we made, any proposal we made, it was required that that proposal, really meet those principles and really move the dial on equity in the state of California. And I feel like we can do that. We can set a new standard. Finally, I think any policy, sometimes we make policy too fast. And then we live for a really long time with things that are legislated that are actually really damaging. And so I think it's about care. It's about, to Brooke's point, the people at the table. We know that there are artists and community leaders and community members who have been doing this work for decades and decades that have not been funded, have not been included. And we also know that they are the best designers of their own systems and structures. And so, you know, this kind of quick top-down legislation, you know, we've got to move to letting people determine how to build policy that works for them and understanding that people are experts in their own communities.
Love that.
I think these are really unsettled times right now, and a lot of models for how we do things are being reinvented or being questioned, and we have to establish new models. I think where economies are shifting, where you have a lot of platform-based work, we need to rethink what are the social structures that pair with them so that there's still stability in light of the sort of the fragmentation of work that is happening. And an analogous example in healthcare, for example, is, if we acknowledge that, you know, hospitals, for example, want a lot more flexibility in their workers because they don't know how healthcare is going to change, that means that more healthcare workers will have sort of temporary status or, you know, flexible status, then how do you make sure that folks can actually access health benefits and retirement? So one of the sister organizations that we just created in January of this year is a healthcare worker co-op. So it's worker owned, and our graduates who are coming out with credential in Futura Health are then able to exit into the worker co-op, and the co-op is the employer of record. It goes out and finds staffs people into temporary placement gigs, essentially with one or multiple employers, and yet is able to provide the benefits and the retirement. So some of these structures are really in very early form, but then you're also seeing concurrently an introduction of legislation of this whole world of worker co-op as a way to sort of antidote to the gig economy. So those are the some of the developments to keep in mind, that it's not just unique to the arts community, but it's a shared interest. And one of the things I know from my work, especially with Gustavo, is you gotta create an echo chamber, right? And the more, the louder the echo chamber, then the more it is heard, especially in Sacramento.
Von, talk to me, help thread that out, the echo chamber. What do you mean by that? It's because I've heard you talk about this all the time, but I think just for the rest of our audience.
Yes, one thing that I've come to discover is that, especially in reform, and I come from more of the higher education, not the arts area, in terms of making big changes in institutions that sort of move and plods along, it's really important to understand that big change, transformational change, is not an individual sport. It's a team sport, right? And so if you're the only one who is interested in it, in making whatever change or making whatever reform or changing the flow of funding, then it's not heard. What we need to do is find common grounds so that others are saying the same thing. So for example, so in this moment in time, we have a lot of uneasiness because the future work is changing. The shelf life of skills is getting shorter and shorter. People don't know where, will higher education be worth the investment because it's being disrupted significantly. Some of the principles that are getting echo chamber type of repetition is like inclusive recovery, right? So that's, you want to be able to plug into that. You want to be able to plug into future work, and that the skills, we don't even know what the skills will be for jobs that don't exist 10 years from now, but will creative skills be essential? Yes. I mean, if you look at human plus skills, transferable skills, both employers and education and the community will all agree to that. So how do you enlist others in carrying your message beyond just you?
100%. Thank you so much, Von. And I think so much of what you threaded out that is happening in the healthcare workforce arena, arts and culture arena, is experiencing the same. We had legislation like AB5 that had a very, very challenging impact effect on our arts and culture sector as a whole. I think many in our sector want to pay, fair living wages and offer benefits and so forth, but we are highly undercapitalized, under-resourced arts and culture sector. And so some of the ideas that you brought forth, like the worker co-op, I think very, very interesting ideas, and I noticed somebody dropped in a link there. Thank you so much. But ideas that perhaps we should be looking at in the arts and culture sector, and figuring out what kind of voice arts and culture can have at those tables also.
Gustavo, if I may interject, something that Van was mentioning sparked an idea in my head. I had a conversation with Jane Chu, who used to run the NEA, and something that Jane mentioned, which hadn't dawned on me before, was the idea that we should be providing grant writing workshops for the more marginalized communities, for people who don't have access to that. And when she cited that, it dawned on me that so much of the work has to do with giving communities the tools they need to be able to engage in a way that does set them up for success. Because I think when we see the barriers to access that a lot of BIPOC nonprofits, for example, are butting up against, it's that they don't have they don't have the tools to write to submit these grants. They don't have a person on staff who's assigned to do the grant writing for them. You know, they don't, for most of these communities, they don't even know where to begin, right? So I think a lot of this larger question that you're posing to us, Gustavo, it's give community, equip communities with the tools they need to succeed. You know, we can't just, you know, give them a bit of funding and say, well, there you go, that should be good enough. You know, then they need the means to make something of that so that they can be on a more level footing. So I just thought that was a very interesting way to look at this larger problem is what tools are lacking? How can we be better at providing these tools to these communities?
And that toolkit, depending on which community we're talking about, it looks different, right? We might, one community might have a couple of tools versus the other might have, you know, the full set to start with. And so what kind of things do we need to do in order to ensure that that everybody has the sort of same working toolkit to be able to build off of that? Makes a lot of sense. So I want to take this moment. Vaughn, you had mentioned, you know, there's a lot of changing and reform that's happening in this moment. It's been a devastating year in the arts and culture sector, but it has also presented some opportunities, I think, for us to really drive some of that more radical change that we're looking, that we need desperately in the field in order to begin to rise a more equitable and a stronger, and to have a just recovery. And so my question for you all is how are you using this moment to advance legislation and or programs that are meeting the needs of artists, that are meeting the needs of arts workers and health workers in the 21st century? Now, I want to turn it over to Deborah. I would love, Deborah, if you could share just some of the amazing work. Touch on anything that you like to touch on, because I know that you're working on a million amazing things. But if you could share a little bit about your Artist GBI program that you're leading, the Guaranteed Basic Income program.
Yeah, I'd be very glad to. And in some ways, it builds also on what Brooke was saying, where I think there's a side of this coin where we need to make sure that people have the tools that they need to succeed. But I would, just to be provocative, suggest that perhaps the systems, the structures, including the way we approach grant making in this country, need to radically change. Like, you know, what would happen if we just gave people money and we let them do what they do best, which is, you know, turn their expertise toward their communities? And when you look at the systems, the economic systems in the arts in this country, you know, if you just fly up and take a look down and think about the idea that we have a lot of money going into the arts, we have a lot of arts organizations, small, medium, and large, and yet our artists, our core community, are struggling, and the economic systems that we create are actually damaging to artists. And so what we need to do is imagine a new way to think about how we invest in artists, how we build capital in communities that have been undercapitalized, and how we can radically reinvent what investment even looks like. The idea that artists are essential investors in their own communities, and their investment is as valuable, if not more valuable, with equal, if not more return than financial investment, right? Like, we need to get to a place where we can think differently, where money is not the only thing that matters. The things that we care about matter. The things that artists and community members care about matter. So for that reason, you know, we're doing a number of different things in a program area at YBCA called YBCA Invest. One of them is an artist-led giving circle. We were working with a crew of artists that we were talking about investment and impact investment and where artists are or are not on the spectrum. And the artists had a conversation about what would happen if one of them was invested in. And as would not surprise many of us here today, the immediate response is one of us is all of us. If one of us is invested in, we are all invested in. And so for YBCA, it was kind of an obvious choice to get out of the way, to take $250,000 from a grant and to give it directly to this group of artists. it is their money. They have the power. They're making the decisions. They will determine how the money is reinvested in their communities. Best we can do is support them and hopefully help them raise more money. So that's one example of exploration of what happens when you acknowledge who the experts are and give them the resources and just get out of the way. The other one is the guaranteed income pilot that we are doing with our mayor here, Mayor London Breed. This is a pilot program where we will be funding 130 artists, $1,000 a month, no strings attached for the first phase of the pilot for 6 months. We're very interested in understanding what happens in a community if you can provide that kind of economic security. Not only what happens for the artist and her family and, you know, housing stability, food security, all of these kinds of things, but also what happens when you unleash creative input, when you free someone from a level of worry and a level of, you know, all the things that have to happen if you don't have steady income. When you free someone from that, what can happen in the rest of the world? What reverberates? You know, our interest in all of this work is to try and test, and sometimes we'll fail. But to learn and in order to advance policy at every level. So those are just two of the examples of things that we're working on.
And I know there are others, Deborah. Thank you for your bold leadership, and keep us posted at Arts for LA on the progress of your guaranteed income for artists program. It's a really interesting time here in Los Angeles because Mayor Garcetti recently proposed $24 million in, I think it's guaranteed basic income program that would fund, I think it's close to 2,000 folks, and so it's an interesting time to think through these very, very bold concepts. I would love to learn from your learnings through your program. So, and please open up the question again to our panel.
So I'll build on that. I think the experimentation with guaranteed basic income, the experimentation with worker co-ops. Again, these are all hedges and experiments to try to figure out antidotes in the future of work, right? And how to put humans back into the center of the future of work. I think there's also another strand of experimentation, and it has to do with skill sets, right? This audience here is particularly has strength in the area of the creative part of the skill sets that are so important in the future work. So when you think about the humans and robots and how we will interact with each other, and of course you've heard all the anxieties about robots taking our jobs, there's reference to a set of skill sets called the human plus skills, formerly known as soft skills, essential skills, 21st century skills, employability skills. But if you look at the four C's that is common across all these discussion of this basket of soft skills, you know, you will always see communication, collaboration, critical thinking, and then creativity. So creativity actually goes for a high premium in the future work as part of the skill set. Now, everybody on this call is a contributor to those that basket of creativity skill. The question becomes, how do you actually display that someone has acquired or has gained some mastery of creativity? And is that something that can be done, again, not as an individual sport, but as a team sport? Because our dilemma is that 10 years from now, the skill sets that are going to be important are not yet predictable. So it may be that my son, who is driving me crazy playing video games, will have the skills to go, you know, do surgery as a physician using all sorts of robotics and devices. And I'm hoping that would be the case where those skill sets are valued. And so it's hard to put value on these skills now when we don't know what the future will hold. However, what we could do is make explicit that if this community, if we believe the creative economy is important, if the world of arts and culture can actually contribute to the manifestation of these skills, then is there a way to badge these skill sets, just like Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts, when you start you know, learning how to do different things. You get physical badges. There's a whole world of digital badges where you can represent these skill sets so that an individual can represent their creativity, because in the future world, it is going to be one of these highly valued skill sets that is transferable and will give us a way to distinguish ourselves from the machines. And this is a hedge to the future work that I think we collectively have to work on, because right now we say, oh, it's very important, but how do you actually evidence that skill set and so that it's portable and postable on our LinkedIn or other types of portfolio?
Got it.
Can I just jump in, which is that, you know, as part of the work on Governor Newsom's task force, I got to work with and got to know Labor Secretary Julie Hsu. And as we know, she's moving to work with Marty Walsh at the Federal Labor Office. And Julie and folks in her office would articulate exactly what you're saying, right? Like we need to understand where the demand is. What are the current jobs that will be needed? What are the future jobs that will be needed? And how do we train and retrain towards those jobs? And there is, I think, a kind of implicit understanding that creativity, flexibility, you know, people who can work in very contextually and culturally specific and sensitive ways are going to be so necessary. And I think our work as advocates is to get that data, like get as much of that, create a really clear line to that story, and integrate ourselves not into an arts worker platform, but into an overall creative workers approach to, you know, from the federal level to the state level, because the artists and creative people will be so needed. They already are. So.
Absolutely. It's so exciting to listen to you all talk about this. My big takeaway from this is when we all hear future of work conversations, the arts have a critical seat at that table. We should be a part of all of those conversations. Brooke, please.
You know, Gustavo, when I was reading your questions and you were talking about what are we doing to meet the need of arts workers and the industry at large, our sector at large, for me, and the reason why we started Be an Arts in the first place is because it was out of desperate need. You know, I'm one of them. I'm fighting for myself as much as I am my colleagues, my friends, my neighbors, etc. When the shutdown happened mid-March, you know, life as I knew it just completely, it came to a halt, right? All of the contracts disappeared into thin air, all production completely halted. So we're not, you know, we're still in the thick of the crisis. So even though we're all getting vaccinated and things are slowly starting to reopen, you know, I think it's given in some ways a false hope that we're getting back to normal and, you know, and that things are A-okay for, what is it, 63% of arts workers in the nation were still fully unemployed, you know, and at this point, many of my friends and colleagues, we've all lost our health insurance because we got our health insurance through our union because our employers paid into our health and benefits and our pension, et cetera, right? So for myself and for many of my friends and colleagues, we're still in a universe that is completely imploded. We're still finding our way through it. So when we talk about desperate need, you know, my co-founders and I looked at each other and we said, well, what's the problem? The problem is folks were getting evicted en masse. Folks were starving because they could not afford to pay for groceries. Folks were, we had many friends and colleagues who were killing themselves because they had no lifeline. When the $600 federal pandemic unemployment compensation disappeared into thin air as of last August 1st, that was the lifeline that was keeping people in their homes. That was the lifeline that was keeping people fed. That was the lifeline that was keeping people in a position where they were able to make their health insurance payments after their health insurance premiums tripled or more. So when I think about need, I say, well, we need to retain the human and the physical infrastructure of our sector. It's twofold. You know, SOS, Save Our Stages was landmark, historical, incredible in so many ways because they were trying to retain and maintain the institutions that employ so many of us. But we can't, that's just one piece of the puzzle, right? What about the human infrastructure that's imploding every day? It's the fabric of our sector, which it's continuing to tear. And we have not yet been able to fully mend that. So when we started taking meetings with Senate and House Rep offices, we were met with, I think it was Harris's office. They told us, "Well, do you have any legislation? Do you have anything written?" We were like, "Well, we're just actors. We're supposed to write that?" And so we were advised by many offices to write our own framework. So we developed something called the DAWN Act. It's Defend Arts Workers Now, which proposed $43.85 billion in relief. At that point, we said we need to spray a giant fire hose of sunshine and money across the entire sector to save our jobs and to save our humans. And as this developed, we started partnering with Americans for the Arts, and we created a landmark joint framework, which teamed DAWN with their Putting Creative Workers to Work proposal, which is in essence almost like a WPA or 2.0. You know, it's really exciting what they've crafted with hundreds of collaborators and thousands of endorsers and supporters. And so we teamed DAWN with Putting Creative Workers to Work so that it then became twofold, a $22 billion relief package and a $22 billion recovery package. Because for us, you know, it's about the people, and it's making sure that we have jobs to return to, so that the physical infrastructure, those warehouses, venues, and institutions stay afloat, so that there are employers who can continue to employ their employees. But what happens when Broadway comes calling and all of the workers have left town? Some of them have killed themselves. Some of them have gotten sick. Some of them are not able to move back to the city to return to their place of work. What happens when the warehouses who make the costumes for Broadway have all shuttered because they were not able to sustain themselves? So we're looking at an ecosystem, an interdependent ecosystem that's hemorrhaging. So I can put more in the chat if people want to read more about where we are with DAWN and PCWW. But for me, it's about tending to the ever-present desperate need that's rampant across our entire sector in this moment. You know, I still don't have my health insurance situation figured out because we just got the 100% COBRA subsidies. I was booted off of my insurance and I couldn't afford it anymore. My only other alternative was getting onto Medi-Cal. I've never even had to think about getting onto Medi-Cal ever in my life. And so it's still an ever-present problem. It hasn't gone away yet. And so I think for me, a large part of the work that needs to be done in this moment is recognizing the folks who are still struggling to make ends meet. This is the fact that thousands upon thousands of nonprofits and institutions, venue operators, have not been able to access or apply for an SVOG, a Shuttered Venue Operator Grants, because of this, the problems we're butting up against with SBA now needing to learn something new and being inundated with and flooded with these requests and not having the technology and the resources and the infrastructure to keep up with this, right? So it's the same thing we face with unemployment. When people were trying to access unemployment benefits for the first time by the millions. So we weren't ready to meet that crisis and how epic that crisis was. So it's a little overwhelming sometimes for me to think about how bad the problem really is. The size and the scope of the problem is so epic, it keeps me up at nights. But I do think that part of the way to recognize the need and to help these communities is to have these conversations, to realize that just because some TV shows have gone back, you know, because Marvel movies are getting released and TV shows are getting back into business, that doesn't mean that the crisis is over.
Right. And Brooke, I just want to recognize, I thank you for sharing more about your personal challenge throughout all of this. I think your challenge is shared by so many artists and arts workers across the country. I thank you for your leadership in tackling these issues head on, as complex and as challenging as they are. There are so many layers to these issues. What we deeply appreciate about your the Be an Arts Worker movement is it's really centering the voices of arts workers in the recovery conversations. And that that feels very appropriate, very right for us to do as a part of building a just recovery for the creative sector. And so—
And we're all arts workers, but we're Be an Arts Hero because we're heroes too.
I love it. Okay, so I am going to quickly shift gears here a little bit because you talked about some of the work, Brooke, that that you all are working through through the Dawn Act, and there are other really interesting and very important proposals that are working its way through the federal government. But I want to talk about a bill that California is working on at this moment. And I want to give a big, big shout out, I think, to Deborah. Because Deborah, through her work on the governor's task force, really has helped pave the road for a bill like the California Creative Workforce Act. So before I jump in and share what the specific act is, I just huge shout out to you, Deborah, for everything that you're doing to try to pave the path for us at really all levels of government.
We're in it together and we're all building on the work of the people who came before. So I'm just, it's very exciting.
It's so, so exciting. And so to everybody who's joining us here, I just want to spotlight a bill, SB 628, Senate Bill 628. It's called the California Creative Workforce Act. This bill is a bill that really recognizes, it does two things. It really recognizes artists as essential workers. And the second is it really aims to establish arts workforce as a priority, as a key priority of the state of California. This bill simultaneously, when you get into the specifics of the bill, it's calling for a living wage and it's calling for equitable access to those jobs. And so at this point, I'd like to cue up just a little video that Senator Ben Allen, who happens to be the senator who is carrying this bill for, if we can cue up that bill for just a couple of words from Senator Allen.
Gustavo, I'm having difficulty. Here we go.
California State Senator Ben Allen here. Proud to represent the 26th District, a very creative part of Los Angeles in the California State Senate, and also serve as the chairman of the legislature's Joint Committee on the Arts, which is a committee that focuses on the challenges and opportunities of our arts sector here in the state of California. And of course, there have been a lot of challenges for arts and artists this year with this terrible pandemic. But in a strange way, the pandemic has, of course, I think, demonstrated to so many of us how much we need the arts, as a healing force for socio-emotional learning and community cohesion. Artists have stepped in as second responders to this crisis and helped us better understand who we are and how to cope with a crisis such as this. Now, artists, of course, need our help, but they also can be part of the solution. It's part of why I introduced SB 628, which is the California Creative Workforce Act, which seeks to create a Works Progress Administration type program to fund artists that will help us to interpret what we've just been through. I know that artists will play an important role in helping California grow and thrive and come out of this pandemic stronger than ever. And so I just want to wish everyone a very happy and meaningful Arts, Culture, and Creativity Month. Join us in helping artists help us as we emerge from this pandemic.
Awesome. So just want to flag that Californians for the Arts is co-sponsoring this bill with Senator Allen, so is Arts for LA. And so you will be hearing more about this bill over the next few weeks. It just recently made it past the Senate Labor Committee and is moving its way into appropriations. And so your community support is going to be incredibly important as we continue to move this important bill forward. And so there are very powerful workforce movement. There's a very powerful workforce movement that's happening right now in the creative sector. It's happening here in the state. It's happening across the country. My question, this one is pointed at you, Yvonne, but what lessons can you share with us in leading powerful workforce development movements? And I'm thinking about the work that you led through the California Community Colleges, where you pushed to increase the budget for career technical education programs through the colleges from $150 million to $1.3 billion over 5 years. Incredibly powerful work. And now you're leading this very ambitious initiative to hire and grow the largest network of credentialed allied healthcare workers. You're aiming for 10,000, I believe. Again, very, very ambitious in nature. And I'm just curious, what advice do you have for us as folks who care deeply about strengthening our creative workforce movement?
Well, Gustavo, thank you for asking. You know, one of my observation in, let me take a step back. So the community colleges, which is a set of 100 and now 115 institutions, were ones that were always in the shadows of the UC system and the Cal State system, especially from a funding point of view. And so similarly, maybe to many of the arts organization, I would, in my role, my prior life as executive vice chancellor would hear, oh, we do all this good work, but nobody recognizes it. Well, why aren't we valued? And when, you know, when it's valued in the parlance of the state capital, you know, what is valued? The funds flow in that direction. So one of the lessons learned was about changing the narrative, right? Changing the narrative. And so what we did was we worked to unify the impact of the community colleges on workforce development, because the legislature didn't know that, hey, it was like they touched one community college, one program. They didn't realize it was connected to a whole network, and that network was having this collective impact on the state. So, I mean, and you can do a litmus test on, you know, where's arts and culture in the narrative right now? So when we talk about the devastation of the pandemic and who is getting unemployed, what is the first sector that people reference? Retail and hospitality, right? But Gustavo, all the statistics that you shared on how disparate the impact was on the arts community, why doesn't it just rattle off right away? It's like, should be hospital, retail, hospitality, arts and culture, blah, blah, blah. You know, so what you can see is that there's an opportunity to shape the narrative so that it's front and center in terms of relevance. Then the you know, Amy Lee, I saw all the wonderful statistics that she put into the chat there. Those are really powerful statistics. And what is it relevant to? It's relevant to what some are referring to is the next pandemic, which is the mental health pandemic, right? So there's a lot of consequences that will follow even after we get all of our vaccinations. And if the arts is actually having those types of impact on healthcare, right? Helping people get better, preventing drug abuse, substance abuse, all sorts of other ills that come with behavioral health issues, shouldn't our policymakers know about it? And shouldn't it be part of the solution in terms of an equitable recovery? It's one of the tools that should be made available and made known. So again, it's about like, how do you recraft the narrative so that it's kind of goes mainstream to what is front and center for on everybody's mind? So that's a key lesson that I learned in addition to this work. Anything on the legislative front, anything on the public funding front is always, it's a team sport. It's not an individual sport.
It's really great. You know, it just reminds me, you know, part of what made it easy and effective to appeal to Governor Newsom and my colleagues on the task force was that I could lean on a significant amount, a mounting data around the role that artists have played in previous crises, the Ebola crisis and HIV/AIDS in particular in juvenile detention centers. And you know, the Jill Sonkey and her team at the University of Florida School for Arts and Medicine spent 2 years working on aggregating what we, you know, putting all the data that we know together, but then also making the case for further work. And what we know, and we're now in a collaboration with the University of Florida, the National Academies, Johns Hopkins, is that while there is a lot of data, it is not synthesizable. It's apples, oranges, and bananas. And we, as a field, have not been good at developing core outcomes processes that are easily accessed by artists, arts organizations, arts leaders, everyone everywhere. What did this community or this life look like before? What does it look like now? What does it look like after? To really kind of move the dial on a body of evidence that we can share in order to advance policy. And, you know, it's what's interesting is it's everything. It's what we know about art in relationship to healing, art that is more reactive to, you know, an individual or community's conditions versus what we know about art when we invest in the arts upstream, way upstream. So we know that art and creativity early and often in people's lives has a significant long-term effect, but we haven't been able to really gather that evidence in order to shift healthcare dollars and other kinds of policies. So we are doing that work with the University of Florida, and that's, you know, it's everybody's welcome. You know, like, we need to do this all together.
Thank you so much for sharing that, Deborah. And it's interesting that you share, you know, we have a lot of data, but it's not synthesizable. And it kind of reminds me a little bit about, I was listening to the opening session, and one of the things that one of the speakers brought up was how it's ironic, but in the arts and culture field, when it comes to advocacy, we have a storytelling issue. And your point kind of brings me back to that point. And so I hear you loud and clear. And so I think my last question here, and then I really want to open it up to our audience to ask any questions, but what advice do you, Brooke, do you, Deborah, have for us on this webinar? As arts advocates for creative jobs, we care deeply about creative jobs. What can we do to strengthen our creative workforce movement at this time?
You know, I would say a large part of that is educating yourself and spreading that information far and wide. What I've learned over the last, being arts here is only like 9 months old, y'all. You know, we're learning as we go, but something that I've learned is that the people have the power, you know? What I've realized is in being in communication with arts advocacy groups and coalitions, institutions, rank and file arts workers, is that people in this moment of social reckoning, in this moment of tremendous upheaval, that people are hungry to do something, to be a part of an epic seismic shift, a change, right? And so, when I think about, you know, what we can do, what can we do to strengthen our workforce? What can we do to strengthen us, to mend the fabric that's been tearing apart at the seams? I think we need to educate ourselves. You know, just the idea that through a teeny tiny grassroots organization like Be an Arts Hero that didn't exist before the pandemic, that we've in 9 months time been able to mobilize hundreds of thousands of people across the nation and even internationally, you know, that speaks to the fact that people are hungry to participate. They're hungry to express their voice, to use their voice, but you need to have a united front of folks getting really loud in order to impart any sort of monumental change, right? And so I think when I take a step back and I look at the situation we're in and I ask myself, how do we strengthen this community? How do we strengthen our sector? How do we strengthen a workforce, a labor force? You know, I think, well, it's about uniting folks so that we're all singing the same song and asking for something that is unified in a way. When I say that, I mean, you know, when the pandemic hit, we were looking at a lot of individual groups advocating for their own individual needs. But because the arts and culture sector is so vast, it isn't just the performing arts industries, it's museums, libraries, broadcasting, publishing, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We're all advocating for our own individual needs because our needs are so different, right? And so part of the disconnect, I think, is that, you know, we would start taking these meetings with senators and House reps, and they would say, there's a pile of 16 different bills just collecting dust in the corner over there because everybody's asking for something different. We don't really know what to do with it. And so it's just, you know, it stopped some of its momentum in some ways. And so it dawned on us that if folks were able to mobilize in a way that we've never done before, you know, if we were no longer operating in individual lanes, if we were able to find some sort of common cohesion, that would create a sort of transition or shift that we've never seen before. These times are unprecedented, but so in that respect, they do require innovative solutions because we can't keep repeating the same solutions that we had in the past because we're in a different moment, right? And so something that was so inspiring to me was seeing groups like NIVA, National Independent Venue Association. They were born out of the pandemic as well. And they, along with a lot of amazing partners, got SOS, you know, through the finish line. You know, it just the idea that they were able to get something like that passed and get it tucked in, it was incredibly unprecedented. And so it's teaching me that if folks are educated, if folks are mobilized and are agitating, you know, that there can be some truly significant change. But it does have to do with a bit of reaching out and saying, you know, how can I help, and getting folks excited to be a part of change. Something that I realized is that, you know, a lot of rank and file arts workers that I knew in my industry in theater and TV and film, they didn't really know how to participate. They didn't really know what my union was doing for us. They didn't really know what the Broadway League was doing to help or hinder. They didn't really understand what was happening on the other side of the aisle. And so engaging people in that process and educating them and getting them involved in that process has shown that we can create seismic change. So I think it's about education, and it's about bringing all of the groups together. This is our Arts Avengers Assemble, Voltron, Captain Planet moment, as it should be. And I think we all need to take advantage of that by truly working together in a way that we've never thought to work together before.
Yeah, and I that was incredible, wonderful. I'd say a couple things. One, support Californians for the Arts, stay involved, stay connected, be part of it. We have an incredible statewide organization. We are very fortunate. So that's one. Two, I think that just to build on what Brooke said, you know, we are easily divided as a sector. Whether it's between large organizations or small ones, or, you know, like, and the challenge there is we can't get very far in terms of public policy and advocacy if we are divided. And so we have to work together. Together we are stronger. And the best kind of advocacy and policy work is going to happen even further beyond just us being a more integrated and collaborative sector, but us integrating into other sectors with similar interests. I think it's just really key. And the last thing I would say is it's all about relationships. At the end of the day, the best kind of advocacy that I've experienced in my life is at the grassroots, in the community, at the local, at the hyper-local level. And it's really about having relationships with people in your communities that are policymakers, that are influencing, and making sure that they know you care about them, that they know you know what they care about, and that you can articulate why the arts are important to that.
Gustavo, can I say one more thing to piggyback off of what Deborah was saying? Everyone has such amazing ideas. It just makes me, it excites me so much. You know, I think another part of it is knowing our worth and knowing our socioeconomic value and educating ourselves so that we can truly understand that. So when we go to lawmakers, we have an argument that is unimpeachable. You can't argue with numbers, right? New numbers from BEA just came out. We're over $919 billion sector in terms of our contribution to the nation's economy. That's 4.3% of the GDP. That's 5.1 million jobs. So we are one of the leading economic contributors in the entire nation, and we should be treated as such. And so I think when it comes to educating and informing arts workers across the nation, institutions, coalitions, arts leaders, you know, it's about knowing what our intrinsic socioeconomic value is so we can have these conversations so that we can truly have seats at the table. There's no reason why we don't have, where we shouldn't have a Department of Arts and Culture, a Secretary of Arts and Culture, when we contribute $265 billion more to the nation than transportation. And there's a Secretary of Transportation and a Secretary of Agriculture, and we outperform agriculture as well. So I think for me, what I've really learned in this over this last year is the more informed and empowered we are, knowing that we are titans in terms of our socioeconomic contributions to the nation, you know, the more we feel confident in asserting our worth, the more we feel as though we can pave a way forward because we know what our worth is, we can demand our worth, and we can really start to move that needle forward.
Amazing. You all are so inspiring. And I think so many great points raised and elevated. I want to elevate one of the points that that Deborah shared around supporting Californians for the Arts. Californians for the Arts, Julie and her team work incredibly hard to put these convenings together. And I'm sure you all have at one point in time put one of these convenings together. It is no easy feat. And so please support Californians for the Arts. I know Californians for the Arts, and you mentioned Brooke Neva, and I believe it's the California Association of Museums have a big ask out there now for $1 billion of the American Rescue Plan dollars to go to the arts. There's a whole campaign around this initiative that Californians for the Arts and those partners are driving. Really, really important effort to drive that kind of seismic shift that we're talking about. And so I think at this point, if any of our folks, our attendees, have a question for any of our panelists, this would be a great time for you all to type in your question in the chat. And if you could just type in the word stack, S-T-A-C-K, and then your question, that would be incredibly helpful. That'll help me. I can read out the questions as they come through. And thank you, Julie, for dropping that question, the link to that campaign right into the message board. So it looks like we might not have any, oh, here we go. Amy Lee, my question is, how do I be an advocate to bridge creative arts and healthcare?
I think it's a fabulous question, but were you gonna jump in? Do you wanna go?
I mean, I think Amy shared a bunch of statistics already, and I think you have to just tie it to the crisis at hand, right? It's like if art is an instrument also to help people get better in the sort of in the mental health crisis, I think that can be part of the narrative for making that case.
We've got another question that came through. How do we improve access to fair wages for artists without crippling smaller arts organizations? Who wants to take that one?
This is exactly how we would do that. But I do think we have to shift the entire economic system, and we need to be able to create policies where public agencies, city governments, municipalities can better support artists and creative people in their communities so that organizations, particularly smaller budget organizations most of whom have huge impact, don't have to carry that burden. It's about the value of artists in society.
Awesome. We have a question from Nicole Winthrop. With the $1 billion recovery funds to artists in mind, I am wondering how to ensure equitable access to these funds. It's a great question. Who wants to take a run at that one?
You know, I think it's about letting your lawmakers know that these are certain priorities, right? If there are barriers to access for marginalized groups, and we have creative solutions on how to remove those barriers, then you got to have those conversations, whether you're having those conversations with local community leaders, with coalitions, with advocacy groups. You know, those conversations need to be happening. My cat's making a cameo. We need to be having these conversations with each other, and we need to be having these conversations with our lawmakers. And so as we hopefully get these relief and recovery funds, you know, we need to be very clear. We need to be intentional about how we want those funds to be dispersed. So I think for me, it's about having those conversations, but really, truly, it's about making sure that demanding, my cat really wants attention. It's about demanding that those needs are met with our lawmakers themselves.
We have a question from Michaela. Michaela, thank you for joining us. How do you manage advocating for your industry while it still has a lot of internal reckoning and change that needs to happen? And Michaela is in theater specifically.
I will tell you that it is a more persuasive case if you begin to do the self work first. So if you think there's reckoning to be done, I mean, I think it's more impressive for others to invest, like the public to invest, once you're beginning to do the self-work. So, you know, Deborah laid out the self-work about, doing the guaranteed basic income, right? If you think that is a model, how do you try out the model so that it can form a bigger public policy? If you think the creative economy is actually, or valued skill sets, begin to do the work. How do you demonstrate that? How do you validate that? How do you evidence that so that those skills are portable and that others can recognize that as part of the employability equation? So, you know, I think a lot of this is it's just hard. I remember back to my days in the community colleges. For everything that we could control, we had to demonstrate that we began to do the changes ourselves. And once we started showing some street cred on that, then others began to follow with additional investment.
It's such a critically important question. Thank you, Michaela, for asking it. And, you know, with the San Francisco Arts Alliance, which is essentially a loose association that started out being large budget organizations sharing best practices, and then they started doing some, you know, lobbying work at City Hall. And over the past several years, since I moved from Intersection, which was a small organization, to YBCA, we've really been focused on how do you actually change that paradigm and create a much more inclusive, broad-based advocacy system, and for those who have the budget to pay for it. and so, you know, when we took Proposition E to the ballot a few years ago, and the larger organizations took on the bulk of the fundraising. They didn't do all of it, but they did the bulk of the fundraising. And the negotiation was about how the majority of the money that would come out of this proposition would address cultural equity. So here you had a situation where larger organizations understood the value of advocating and fundraising for something that would keep their money steady or reduce it slightly, but would be really about increasing funding to other organizations. So it's an example of like, we're in it together, we're stronger together. In the long run, that's gonna help everyone to approach it in that way. So I hope that we can all see that giving is, we are not giving up things that don't already belong to us anyway. It is all a shared resource and we need to share it better.
Thank you all so much. We have a whole nother set of questions. but that we won't be able to get to. And so I've copied and pasted these questions, and we'll see if we could get you responses on the back end to these questions. But just want to thank our amazing panelists for sharing all of your thoughts, for your leadership, for being a part of this important conversation that is really about workforce building, workforce movement building, crossing the disciplines, crossing the sectors. I just want to thank you all for everything that you do every single day. You're an inspiration to all of us. And so I know there's a panel coming up right now for Californians for the Arts. So thank you all for joining us, and we'll see you soon.
Thank you so much.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.